Pick from Shepherd's Ministries to come up, and Al's going to give us an overview of their ministry. So welcome, Al.
Well, we appreciate the opportunity to come and just catch you up to date on Shepherd's. It's a great ministry of providing love and compassion for people with intellectual disabilities. We're located in Union Grove, Wisconsin. So if you ever are away and want to stop by and visit and see the ministry, we always appreciate people coming by and seeing the work that we do. So we're just going to run through a slide presentation here real quick and get you up to date on the ministry. So when I go like this, we'll move the slide. We got it. And this is our, we have a 92-acre campus there in Union Grove. We're thankful for it. We're thankful for how God has provided over the years, and we're thankful that we don't have any mortgages or any debt, and we're just thankful for God's provision, and we're just thankful for how he provides and that we can give hope for people with intellectual disabilities, just hope for their life, guide them and direct them, and we're just thankful for the opportunity that we have. We have a couple of core values that we like to share with you. Shepherds, we want to honor God and we want to value people. We're just thankful for our great God, and we want to do the best we can in serving him, and we're just thankful for the people that he's given to us. We're thankful that we can help them and just show them respect as they progress and love them while we're doing it. We basically operate from this presupposition that is called appropriate independence, that all people are designed on and for a purpose. There's no mistake. God have a purpose and plan for each person, that each person is created as individuals for community, and we have that responsibility to train them for life, that they'll be empowered to serve. And we offer four aspects of the ministry that are shepherds. We have a residential program that's both on campus and independent in the community. We have Camp Discovery for high school kids and junior high, that they might have the opportunity to participate in the ministry. Then we have Shepherd's Enterprises, the vocational side. And then Shepherd's College. We have Shepherd's College, a three-year post-secondary educational institution for people with intellectual disabilities, the only Christian college in the nation that provides care for just people with intellectual disabilities. So we have our residential program, providing care 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year to people with intellectual disabilities, just providing them a wonderful home, a wonderful place to live, to grow, and the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus. We also have the Catalyst Program, which is our independent program, people living in the community. More and more of the families, when they bring their adult children to Shepherd's, they want them to live in the community, and we can provide that for them through our Catalyst Program. And we can just provide, like Becky here, a home for them, invite you in to have, serve you dinner. Becky's quite a gal. She's also on our U.S. Olympics team, a Special Olympics team in skiing, and so she's quite a gal. She invites you into her house. We have a day service center for people who just need a little extra help in their lives. We can provide that for them through the day service center, just giving them a wonderful life, opportunities for work, and just providing for them in that special way. Our spiritual life program, we believe, is the core of the Shepherd's. We want each person to come to know the Lord Jesus as their Savior. We want their lives to be changed by the power of God, them to live for the Lord. We have a mentoring program, a discipleship program. We have a music program, worship program for the people there. Just provide for them, care for them, wanting them to grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus, to grow each day, and we can provide that for them. We started as a result of a Sunday school class in a local church, and it's grown into the Shepherd's Ministry we have today, and we just want to put that emphasis on that spiritual growth. We do not take any direct federal or state money, because we want to have the opportunity to share the gospel and see people come to know the Lord. We have a respite care service. Respite care is for people who are the main caregivers of their loved ones, but once in a while they want a respite. Once in a while they just like to have a break from caring, and we can provide that short-term care. Just gives them an opportunity to come and spend a short time with us while mom and dad or the guardian takes a break. It is also a program that introduces people to Shepherd's who wants to become a future resident of Shepherd's. They have to actively participate in the respite care program. So it's a great program provided for people. We have people there every day who are not resident of Shepherd's, but they're part of the respite care program. We also have Camp Discovery. Camp Discovery is for the high school, junior high kids who come and participate in a camp ministry just for spiritual growth, for fun, recreation. Just a great time for high school and junior high kids to come. There's also a time they can be introduced to Shepherd's and then we have Shepherd's Enterprises. Shepherd's Enterprises is our vocational side, vocational training and job opportunities. When a person comes to Shepherds, we run them through a program on the importance of work, the dignity of work, accountability of work. How do you get up and go to work? How do you become a working person? We believe that's how you honor and glorify God in your life. And so we do provide job opportunities through Shepherds Enterprises. We do that on campus, off campus, or just hired to work for Shepherds. We have different work contracts. We have two or three main ones. We have a couple of contracts. One is here shown in the picture of our ball bearings contract, where they grease the ball bearings, pack the ball bearings, and send them out. It's a company that subcontracts for John Deere and Caterpillar. It's been a very good contract for us. And then we also have one with a hair care company that makes barber equipment, and we do the packaging for that. They can work off campus in different places, restaurants, hotels, hospitals, nursing homes, just different opportunities to work. And so we can provide for them through the ministry there at Shepherd. Just gives them an opportunity. So we do contract with 12 different companies. The other companies are nuts and bolts and packaging, and just give an opportunity for people at Shepherd's. You know, they love payday too. And so gives them an opportunity for work and dignity in life. Then we have Shepherd's College. Shepherd's College is a 3-year post-secondary educational institution for people with intellectual disabilities. It's the only Christian college of its kind in the nation that reaches out to people with intellectual disabilities. It's fully accredited by North Central Accreditation. It's recognized by the U.S. Department of Education, and so we're just thankful for it. We started 5 years ago with 5 students. Today we have 60 students. The next year we anticipate about 75, and so we're just thankful for the growth each year of the college and reaching out to that certain group of people. The college reaches out to a people with an IQ of 55 to 75. And 75% of the people with intellectual disabilities in America today are in that range of 55 to 75 IQ. And so we reach out to that group of people just to have a ministry to them. They just come to Shepherd's for 3 years, and then they go back home to their community, and we hope to give them a skill that they might be able to work in the community and be a part of the community. So it works like this. Come from home and school, come to Shepherd's College, be prepared for work and community. And so we're excited about the college. We believe that's sort of a future direction of Shepherd's. Just have them come for 3 years, and we stress that first year, daily living skills, you know, functional academic skills, just social and emotional skills that they need for their daily lives. Then that spiritual emphasis, they all take a Bible minor. They all take Old Testament, New Testament, evangelism, discipleship, church history, apologetics, just that whole realm, every 2 Bible courses each semester that they might just be grounded in the Word of God and be a part of a local church when they leave. Now, the college is open to everybody. You don't have to be a Christian to come. And because of that, we've seen 19 kids come to know the Lord the last couple of years. So we're just really thankful for that opportunity to have an impact in their lives. The first program we have is a horticulture program. In their 3rd year, they have to do an internship every Friday, every week in the morning. They have to go do an internship in a nursery setting or a garden setting, a garden type of a setting, and or a farm setting. It gives them an opportunity just for an internship just to, so they might be able to apply what they know. And so it's also, they have floral design, landscaping, a nursery garden operations. Just give them that background in the whole nursery and garden operations. We have a full-fledged greenhouse there at Shepherd's, and it gives them an opportunity to grow different things and to sell them in farmers markets and just be able to learn a lot about the whole horticulture business. And then we also have the culinary arts program. The culinary arts program is the more popular of the two. Everybody wants to be on the cooking channel, and so, you know, it's the opportunity for them to just be whole, trained in the food service business and culinary skills. Just gives them that opportunity in life, and we're just thankful for that. For people, if you go by, like, on the Highway 20 and I-94, the pilot station there, there's a couple of them doing their internship there, you know, flipping burgers, helping out in the restaurant there at the Iron Skillet. But they also work in the public school kitchens, work in nursing home kitchens. Give them an opportunity just to learn a skill and be a part of the community when they leave Shepherd's College. We rearrange some of the campus there. It's their first year, they live in dorm setting. And the dorm settings have large kitchens because the students do their own cooking from day one. So from day one, just to teach them how to be independent. It's a little dangerous to eat with them maybe the first week, but then after But after that, it gets a little better each week. So we're really always thankful for it. Second year, they live in houses, and the houses both have two large kitchens in them. Third year, they live in an apartment complex. Just each year, just a little step towards independence. So it's just a wonderful opportunity for people with intellectual disabilities. And you might ask, where would that be, a 55 to 75 IQ range? And that is a third grade reading and math comprehension. And that's what we work with, those people with intellectual disabilities, that we can have an impact upon their lives. And so we're just thankful for shepherds, thankful for the found on the Word of God. We have a born-again staff. We have an evangelistic outreach, that we have Christ-centered, that we want Jesus Christ to be preeminent in our life, have that local church emphasis. We're just thankful for the local churches, thankful that they can support us and pray for us. We're thankful for our friend program, a youth program, where the high school youth groups come and they spend a week with us, have an opportunity to work with people with intellectual disabilities, a life-changing experience. You can save your Campbell labels if you save Campbell labels. I've been a shepherd 20 years. We've gotten 14 minivans through that program. You know, when I started, you could get a minivan for 600,000 labels. Today it's 1.9 million, so inflation runs even with soup. You have to eat more soup to keep up with the demand. So volunteer groups really put that stress. Shepherd Sunday, like today, just coming and sharing the ministry. And we're always thankful for it. But we do stress local churches to be involved with us, to volunteer and come and just be a part of our ministry for a day or two. Volunteering and helping people with intellectual disabilities is a real challenge in life. Just gives you a real compassion. You can come as individuals, or you can come as a group. We always have those different opportunities for service. And we're just located in Union Grove. You'll want to come and just be a part of that. And our Shepherd's Friend program is the high school program. Just give those high school kids opportunity to open up their eyes to see how people with intellectual disabilities live and the challenges they face, to have a heart of love and compassion for them. And then we have the Assistant Resident Program. These are little programs we have back there in our display, right when you enter into the foyer. So if you would like to sign up for our sheet, we are really thankful for the opportunity to come and just share shepherds with you. And here is our little program that shows that we're 56 years old. There's an aunt that's part of the resident, and her nephew is one of the students. So, Doug, I just think I'll have you come on up and share. We always want to give an opportunity for the people as shepherds to minister in local churches. And so I got my friend Doug, woke him up early this morning, and have him come and be a part. So thanks a lot for coming, Doug. Appreciate it. Doug, why don't you just tell him your name and where you're from?
My name is Doug Little, and I am from Colorado Springs, Colorado.
Yep, Doug lives in Colorado Springs, Colorado. I've been to Doug's house several times. We looked right out the window. What do we see?
We see Pike's Peak and April's Academy.
Yep, so that's great. So we always appreciate Doug, always appreciate him being a part of the ministry. Doug, you've been a shepherd a few years, haven't you?
Yeah, I was there for 28 or 29 years, going 30 years.
Yeah. And you went through our high school program, graduated from that. And what did your mom and dad do there in Colorado Springs?
Well, my mom, my dad were the missionaries to the Navigators for 50, 51 years.
Yep, and so.
And they put me in shepherds.
Yep.
And they want me to live here and work.
Yep. Where do you work at Shepherds? Who do you work
at Shepherds, I work at different places. I know I was working in the kitchen, but now I'm at Shepherd's Enterprise.
And what do you do there?
I do clipper kits, and sometimes I do bearings.
Yep, you've been doing the bearings lately, haven't you? And what do you do with the bearings?
They send us different sizes.
Yep.
If you have a small bearing, you take only one quick pump, and the grease come through the bearing, and then you take the bearing off the pump, and then you take the bearing and you have to clean the bearings, and then you lay it on the paper, and then you put it in the box.
Yeah, so that was a good job, isn't it? You guys really been doing a lot of bearings, haven't you?
Yeah, we did. And our job coach is John.
Oh, John, he's a good guy, huh? Yep. And
and he said which our goal, and our goal was like 8,000 or 9,000 already. Yeah, we're going to knock them out tomorrow.
Knock them out tomorrow. Praise the Lord. You bet.
But I accept it's not my, well, I know I do like it, but No, it stinks. And if you guys come over there, don't smell me.
Yeah, we won't. I promise. Yep, that's great. Well, Douglas, did you watch the ball game last night?
I watched the NCAA basketball last night on TV. I know the guys winning the Badgers. I said, well, I know your team's played good, but Kentucky got the taste. So goodbye, Badger.
Yeah, we just happen to have a Kentucky fan with us. There's a Philistine always in the midst, isn't there?
Yeah, but I still love him.
Yeah, I know. That's right. That's great. Well, what a night. Well, then listen, Doug, you have any sports you like to play?
At Shepherd's, we have sports. We do baton relay, softball throw, volleyball, and basketball. And some of the people from the Special Olympics went to Oshkosh, and one of our teams won the first game. And like the other teams, well, they're coming home today, but I think they won the three teams already. I think they got first place.
Oh, well, I don't know yet.
I hope they get first. Yeah.
The Shepherds team was at the state championship, so they were hoping they win.
Today
is the finals.
And I'll be glad if they come back today. They said they're gonna win it for me.
Oh, right. I don't like that. Well, Doug, you know, if we're in the local church and sharing the gospel, we always want to give you an opportunity to share the gospel with the folks. And where would we begin, Doug?
Well, there's people here. If you guys does not know the Lord, you guys and I going to heaven. You guys might go to hell, and hell is not a place to live. You have your choice. Do you want to hell or heaven? You know what? I choose heaven, because heaven is a wonderful place. I'm going to be walking on the streets of God to see my mom.
Yeah, you bet. Praise the Lord. And where would you start if you didn't share the gospel with somebody, Doug?
That we are sinners. Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God.
That's right. So where we start. We've all missed the mark. We've all fallen short of the standards God sets forth in His Word. But what else does the Bible tell us?
That God loved us. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have eternal life.
That's so true. Praise the Lord. Even though we're sinners, God loves us. And how did He show His love for us?
That God loved us.
Well, how did He show His love for us?
Christ died for us. Romans 5:8. But God commendeth His love toward us. If we're still sinners, Christ died for us.
That's so true. You know, even though we're sinners, God loves each one of us and sent Jesus to die in our place, our substitute for our sins, didn't He? And when we know that, what should we do?
That we need to receive Him. John 1:12. But as many as received Him, to them give the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on His name.
That's right. When we open up our heart and receive Him in our lives, what happens, Doug?
We'll be saved. Acts 16:31. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house.
Yep. You know, Doug, if somebody realizes they're a sinner and that God loves them, they receive Jesus in their life, how would they know they're saved?
1 John 5:12-13. He had a son had life. He had not.
He had not the son, didn't it? Had not the life. But these things, I know once we get interrupted. Yeah, we have eternal life, don't we? We know we have eternal life, right, brother?
Yeah, and from this people who is up there, I like that son. He is our lion. Yeah. I know He can roar, and I know He's the best king. Now I said to my Lord, you know what I call Him? I call Him Kings of Kings and Lord of Lords.
Yep.
That's what my mom's looking for.
Yeah, you bet. Well, we have a short little video, a little video about Shepherd's College.
Shepherd's College is the country's leading accredited post-secondary school for young adults with intellectual disabilities. Learn more about us at shepherdscollege.edu.
Thank you, Al and Douglas. I just want to tell you, stop and see. There's a display in back. Talk to Al if you have any questions. You might think you want to volunteer there. Maybe you want to. God's put it on your heart to give to Shepherd's Ministries. If that's the case, you can write a check either to Shepherd's or write it to Mount Zion, mark it on the envelope, put it in the tithe slot, and we'll make sure that they get it. We are going to go into John chapter 6, but as we're going there, I want to tell you, I think Douglas is one of the best preachers we've ever had, don't you? I really think so. It's awesome. Fantastic. This morning as we prepare to come to the table, we're in John chapter 6, okay? I'm going to set the scene for you. I'm going to begin in verse 40, but before we get there, what you need to know, Jesus and his disciples, they actually traveled to the east side of the Sea of Galilee, okay? It's when you go to Israel, they say we're going to the Gentile side, okay? And they go to the west side of the Sea of Galilee. It's where Gadara is. It's where Jesus cast out the demons and the Gadaran demoniac. And he went over there, and he was teaching, and the crowds flocked to him. And Jesus said to his disciples, where are we going to buy food for them? And they said, man, it would take a year's wages for everybody just to get a bite. There were 5,000 men there. And Jesus, as you know, he took five loaves and two fish, and he blessed them, broke them, and he fed the entire crowd. He had so much, they had 12 baskets left over. Okay, so that evening, Jesus sent the crowds away, and his disciples got in the boat to get back over to Capernaum and to get back to their hometown. And Jesus waited behind, and then he walked on the water, and he got in the boat, and they arrived there. And then the next day, everybody was looking for Jesus. They had a free lunch the day before, and they weren't going to let this guy go. So they come all the way over. They come back over on the other side of the Sea of Galilee in boats, and they come back. And then Jesus gets in to this dispute with the Jews. And I'm going to pick it up in the 40th verse. I recommend that you read the whole chapter because I'm going to miss some of it, but you're going to get the context as we prepare to come to the table this morning. I'm going to begin and read verses 40 through 50, and then we'll go through your outline in your notes. Jesus says, for my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. At this, the Jews there began to grumble about him because he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. They said, is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say, I came down from heaven? Stop grumbling among yourselves, Jesus answered. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws them, and I will raise them up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, they will all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard the Father and learned from him comes to me. No one has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he has seen the Father. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes has eternal life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, yet they died. Father, I ask that you come in the precious name of Jesus, that you come with revelation from your Holy Spirit and guide us into all truth today. Amen. If you're following in your outline, your first point, eternal life is the Father's will for all who believe in Jesus. Have you ever gotten, I can't imagine anybody here being in this place, but have you ever gotten in a dispute over religion or over religious things or scripture? And so often we would miss this point. Eternal life is the Father's will for all who believe in Jesus. Sometimes when you get in a dispute, you get so into winning your case or making your point, you forget that there are souls of men and women that are hanging in the balance. I want you to notice in the text as we read, these people are after Jesus. Jesus never loses sight of the fact that it's about people's souls. That's why he says, it's my Father's will that you will have eternal life and that on the last day I will raise you up. And so I pray that when you get into these conversations and that when you get into, you know, heated fellowship, that you would never lose sight of the fact that it's about that person's soul. It's not about you winning the argument. It's about the souls of men and women. Now, in your next point, Jesus puts himself in the place of manna that gave Israel life in the desert. You see, they were all saying to Jesus, Moses gave us manna that fell from heaven. And Jesus has to correct them. He says, it wasn't Moses that gave you the manna. It was my Father in heaven. But Moses is a hero to them. Manna is just such a big deal to them. You know, they're bragging about it. But Jesus takes himself in this text and in this dispute, and he puts himself in the place of the manna. He said, the real bread that came down from heaven is right here. It's me. I am the bread of life. If you're following in your outline, your next point, Jewish hearers believe manna in the desert came from heaven, but do not believe Jesus is from heaven. What's going on here, if you set the scene and if you really could get into this text, is the same thing that Israel's ancestors did in the desert, they're doing this very day with Jesus standing right in front of them. You see, all those who were in the desert, except for Joshua and Caleb and all their children, they went in. But all of the older generation all died in the desert because they were eating the manna, but they didn't believe in the one who gave the manna, and they didn't give him honor, and they didn't give him glory. Now here, with Jesus right in front of them, they believe in Moses. They believe in the manna that fell from heaven. They certainly believe in the miraculous bread that Jesus fed them the day before, don't they? That's why they all came running over. 5,000 of them were fed with 5 loaves of bread. Try that on a Sunday afternoon. And man, they believed in that. They had their faith in that food. But Jesus is standing right in front of them, the Son of God, and they're arguing over him. Going, you can't say that you came down from heaven and that you're the bread of life. They're about to commit the same sin their ancestors commit. If you keep following in your outline, ingesting manna did not result in eternal life. See, they ate the manna, but they didn't believe in the one it came from. They didn't obey. And then look at your next point. Ingesting Jesus results in eternal life. Now, once again, I think this is the third or fourth week in a row I've said this. Jesus goes from working on the outside, and he goes to becoming holy on the inside. That's what he's after here. That's why he says, I'm the bread of life. And he says, unless you eat this bread and unless you drink my blood, you won't have eternal life. Let's read on in verses 51 through 59. Jesus says, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. And then the Jews began to argue sharply among themselves. How can this man give us his flesh to eat? Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and you drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. For my flesh is real food, and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in them. And just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven." And he says it again now, "Your ancestors ate manna and died, but whoever feeds on this bread will live forever." And he said this while teaching in the synagogue in Capernaum. If you're following in your notes, over and over, we've been teaching this in the past weeks. Jesus speaks a spiritual truth that his flesh is real food and his blood is real drink. If you try to take this in the flesh, you're going to miss it. Your next point, in the flesh, this is cannibalism and against all Jewish law. You see, they were taught you would never drink blood. You never touch blood. And Jesus is saying to them, unless you eat my flesh and unless you drink my blood. And Jesus, we're going to explain it in a minute, is speaking a spiritual truth. Another thing, as we go through the Gospel of John, you have to take spiritual truth. In the second chapter, Jesus says, "I'll tear this temple down and rebuild it in 3 days." They said, "You are out of your mind, man. You don't even have any big machinery here. You don't have a caterpillar. You don't have anything you need. And it took 46 years to build. How are you going to tear it down and build it back up?" It says he was speaking about his body. Jesus was going to die on the cross and be raised from the dead. In chapter 3, he tells Nicodemus, you have to be born again. You have to be born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said, in the flesh, he goes, "How can I go back into my mother's womb?" And Jesus said, no. He said, you should understand it. It's a spiritual truth. In the 4th chapter, Jesus tells his disciples, "I have food to eat that you guys don't know of. It's to do the will of my Father." And they're looking around like, did somebody bring him some sandwich, man? Did he drive through Burger King while we were out? What happened? He's speaking a spiritual truth. If you're here this morning and all you can deal with is what you can see and feel and hear and touch, you're going to struggle with the Word of God. I had somebody I really love one time tell me, because some churches, they say that this bread's actually going to turn into flesh, and they say that this cup is actually going to turn into blood. It's called transubstantiation. That's not what Jesus meant here when he said this. And I've had people that I really love tell me, I just can't believe God's in that bread and that God's in that cup. And you have to explain to them, wait a minute, look at what Jesus said here. It's a spiritual truth. As we move on in verses 60 through 69, on hearing it, many of his disciples said, "This is a hard teaching. Who can accept it?" And aware that his disciples were grumbling about this, Jesus said to them, "Does this offend you?" Now, I love this about Jesus before I read this. Have you noticed when Jesus gets in a place that's volatile, rather than backing off and doing damage control, he just gets a bunch of gas and throws it on the fire? That's what he does here. Listen to what he says. "Then what if you see the Son of Man ascend to where he was before?" He says, you guys are struggling with the bread, with my flesh and blood. But he said, what if you see me ascend into heaven, which will prove that that's where I came from? Wow. Now listen to this verse. "The Spirit gives life and the flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you, they are full of the Spirit and life." Some translations say, "The words I have spoken to you, they are spirit and they are life." Don't miss it. Jesus is explaining the words. He just said, my flesh is real food, my blood's real drink. He said, these are spiritual words. I'm speaking a spiritual truth to you. "For Jesus had known from the beginning..." "Yet there are some of you who do not believe, for Jesus had known from the beginning which of them did not believe and who would betray him. He went on to say, this is why I told you that no one can come to me unless the Father has enabled them. And from this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. You, do you want to leave too, do you? Jesus asked the 12. And Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God." If you're following in your outline, carnal minds found this teaching unacceptable. They just couldn't grasp what Jesus had said. They were still in the flesh. They just couldn't take him at his word. And it says they began to walk away. You know what I think in this text? I think a lot of them walked away before they heard Jesus say, "The words I speak to you, they are spirit. I'm speaking a spiritual truth to you." I don't know if you guys know this, but if you hang around long enough and you keep questioning Jesus, he's going to explain stuff to you. In the same way Scripture interprets Scripture here, don't run away. Hang in there. Say, "Lord, I love you with all my heart, but give me understanding." And he'll bring revelation by the power of his Spirit. And so many in this context walked away. They came for a free lunch. They came for bread they could touch and feel and eat. And Jesus wanted to give them spiritual food that would last for eternity. And they walked away and they gave up before they understood. If you're in here today and you have questions and you're wondering about this and you're wondering about that, could I please encourage you, hang in there with God. Seek God out. Ask him, "Lord, show me in your word, Lord. Bring somebody up to me to speak to me today, but Lord, bring revelation." After the service last night, somebody came up to me and they said, "You know what? This was just this huge breakthrough today for me." Don't walk away from God. Run to God and he'll give you the answer. Seek his word. He'll give you the answer. Your next point, we've already talked about it. He explains himself in verse 63. "The words I speak to you are spirit and they are truth." Hear what he says. He says, "The flesh profits nothing." But he says, "The words I speak to you," he says, "they are spirit and they are truth." You see, spirit gives life. That gives life, but the flesh counts for nothing. Your next point, Jesus asks his 12 disciples if they want to leave. Wow. And I love this text for Peter's sake. Because Peter, he gets a bum rap sometimes for some of the things he says and what he does, but in this one, man, he hit it just right, didn't he? Peter answers Jesus faithfully. He says, "Lord, to whom shall we go?" He says, "We've come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God." And he says to Jesus, "You have the words of eternal life." Lord Jesus, we are going to come to this table now. And Lord, I believe that your food or your flesh is real food. I believe your blood is real spiritual drink. And Lord, I believe what you say, that unless we eat your flesh and we drink your blood, we won't have anything to do in eternity. We'll never make it to heaven. And Lord, I heard what Douglas said. He said, "I want to go to heaven. I don't want to go to hell." Father, I ask that you would come now with the power of your Holy Spirit, that, Lord, if there's one person in here that has never surrendered their life to you, Lord Jesus, that, Lord, right now as we're passing out the bread, that, Lord, they would come to you and they would ask for forgiveness for their sins. And then, Lord, we understand that this bread we're going to take represents your body and this drink we're going to have represents your blood. And Lord, I also believe you're here with the power of your Spirit to work miracles in our life today. Let's go to the table.
You came sin. Who knew no sin? We might become. himself, carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. Name above.
Lord Jesus, we know that this bread represents your body, which you
allowed to be nailed to the cross.
Lord, I pray that we will never become like the people we read about today. Lord, they were so into manna from heaven. They were so into bread that they were fed here on this earth on the other side of the Sea of Galilee. They just loved that bread and they couldn't live without it. But Lord, they missed you. So Lord, this morning we recognize you and we recognize that we have to partake of the fact that you died on the cross for us. Lord Jesus, when we eat this bread, we're proclaiming that we put our faith in you and that we know that you are the Son of God who came and died for us. Let's receive the bread of life.
His body, the bread, his blood, the wine, broken and poured.
the Gospel of John chapter 6, Jesus said, if you don't believe in him, you will die in your sins. Lord Jesus, I am so thankful for the blood that you shed on the cross for me. And Lord, if you hadn't done that, I would be dead in my sins. If you hadn't gone to the cross and died and been raised up on resurrection morning, I would be dead in my sin. But Lord, because you did come, and because you didn't shrink back, and you went to the cross and you shed your blood, Lord, this morning I'm redeemed. I've been cleansed from all unrighteousness. So Father, I thank you for what Jesus has done. Lord Jesus, we recognize you, and we thank you and we praise you for your precious blood. As we drink, we acknowledge what you've done for us. Let's partake. Lord Jesus, I pray that you will work miracles in our lives today. That, Lord, you will meet our needs. You will give us knowledge. You'll give us wisdom. You will heal us physically, mentally, and spiritually. Father, pour out your spirit. Bring your anointing now this morning. Guide us, Lord Jesus, and help us to add to your kingdom in your precious name. Amen. If you need prayer, we're here. We'd love to pray for you. If you need time at the altar, there's time at the altar. If not, you're free to go in peace to love and serve the Lord. God bless you. Don't forget to stop and talk to Al and Douglas on your way out. God bless.